So good morning, everybody, and welcome to the session on assessing societal impact of automated border control in this panel. It is organized by the project ABC for EU, which is funded under the Summit Framework Program. Automated border control has the aim of providing more security, faster processes when crossing the borders. But there are also societal implications and fundamental rights that are involved. So the first question that we will have to look at it is what we perceive as the true purpose of automated border control. Is it better immigration control, reduction of cost, better security control, which is particularly important in these days, or is it all of this? And how does this, if there's some clarity about the purpose in terms of societal impact and ethical conditions, what does this clarity mean in terms of the effects on societal impact, ethical conditions, and fundamental rights? The panel will look at these implications and bodily impact, how privacy by design could be an answer, if the technology has all the answers, rather practical consideration, how does this all in present context where we have a priority to fight terrorism, serious crime. Now I will briefly introduce the panelists, which I think come in from various important perspectives and will shed light on various angles on these issues. Moderating at this panel, we have Shane McCarthy. She comes from the Center for Irish and European Security and has a particular interest in concepts of privacy and fundamental rights and in understanding the societal governance of our security policies. We have Anne-Marie Oostveen in the middle here, focus on interdisciplinary study of design uses and consequences of ICTs and how they interact in an institutional cultural context. And she's an expert in societal implications in these issues. Irma van der Ploeg from Maastricht University. She has published extensively on ethical and societal aspects of surveillance and identification technologies, in particular biometrics. And she's an expert on bodily differences play in. Mark Maguire, which is on the other side here of Anne-Marie, is an anthropologist and heading the Maynooth University Department of Anthropology. Anthropology and security is field of expertise, and he brings in the aspects into this panel, what does security aspects mean, and also fighting terrorism in this context. Then we have Peter Graham at the far end. He brings in practical approaches from his work on borders, comes from the private sector, but also see how the issues play in at the border in a very concrete manner. Then we have Gemma Galdon Clavell. She's a policy analyst working on surveillance, and she works on the project sponsoring this event, ABC4EU. And she will deal with the society. She is an expert in societal, legal, and ethical impact of technology, and has concentrated on responses by the technology through privacy by design issues. Myself, I'm the chair of the panel. I work in the sector on migration, asylum, and borders and peace at the Fundamental Rights Agency of the EU. And I'm presently managing a project on large-scale databases on biometrics in the EU, in the areas of asylum, peace, and borders, and how fundamental rights play in. And this year we will also contract out certain parts of our research. A distinction to keep in mind before we go to listen to the panel is two issues, which are basic. Why do we use biometrics in a border automated border context? The first is the purpose of verification, which meaning that you verify that this person in front of you is the same as that person claims to be by comparing the live biometrics with those stored about the person. Then we have means usage for identification, which means that the fingerprints are then matched again, or the biometric features match against those stored in the database. And a larger number of fundamental rights implications and others come into play in this second context. I will not go on any further because we have many interesting views to look into. I will go all over to the first panelist, which is Anne-Marie. And Shane, the moderator, will make sure that nobody will exceed the 10 minutes given to them for each presentation. And then after that, we will take questions from the floor before concluding the session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So I will talk a bit about the work that I've done on another EU project called FastPass, which is also interested in ABCs, not just for airports, where they are mainly used at the moment, but also for land borders and sea borders. But my focus will be on air traffic or airports, because that's where they are used currently, and so that's where the focus will be. At the moment, almost every year, air traffic, the volume of air traffic increases by about 4 to 5%. And this is expected to continue in the coming years, which means that by 2030, there will be about 6.4 billion passengers, which is an enormous amount, and it's almost double the amount of air traffic passengers there are now. So of course this brings challenges. You know, if there are so many passengers, there are issues related to security, issues to the speed of the process of going through border control. The cost, of course, because you need more border guards, or you need to have border guards who can deal with you know, the interesting sort of travelers, and the rest is automated. And but also customers these days have more and more and higher expectations of service, and therefore the idea is, if we automate this, if we introduce e-gates, then this will solve these problems. It might be a solution. Well, obviously, if you are thinking about developing automated border control, e-gates, you have to take into account the needs and requirements and the values of many different stakeholders. So you have, for instance, the border guards who need to work with the systems. You've got political stakeholders, you've got the travel document providers, you've got the travelers, you've got the suppliers of the hardware and the software. And all of these things need to be taken into account. Today, what I'll do is that I'll focus on the travelers and how they feel about ABCs and biometrics and these systems in general. So what we've done within the project is that we, first of all, interviewed travelers. So we had interviews with 155 passengers at a major airport, international airport in Europe. We also conducted observations of people actually using the e-gates. And finally, we conducted a couple of focus groups where we went more in-depth about issues related to biometrics and future scenarios, how will this develop, and how do people feel about this. So overall, what we found is that people are in favor of ABCs. Passengers, like, if they've never used it themselves, they like the idea. If they've used them, then they're quite positive about them, and mainly because they feel it speeds up the process. What we see here is a quote from one of the focus groups where somebody says, you know, when I'm getting off a flight, I just want to get through border control as quick as possible. I don't want somebody asking me loads of questions, so I like the idea of just putting my passport down, going through a gate, and have no interference of an actual person. They just want to get where they are as quick as possible. And this is the case with people. People, you know, often have been on long flights, are tired, and are in places that they're not familiar with, so they don't see ABCs and putting your passport down and having a facial scan as intrusive, because they say, well, we're already, when you go through border control, we're used to having a lot of questions. Where are you going, what are you doing, how much money have you got on you? So because of this context, they don't feel particularly concerned about it. So even though they're positive about it, we've seen that it is ABCs are still underused. So there are reports, there is for instance a report from the UK, which is a 2013 report, which showed that in the UK it's quite a popular thing. So at 15 different locations they have about 65 e-gates, but only 31% of eligible users actually use these things. We also interviewed border guards at Schiphol and in Frankfurt and things like that, and they said the same thing, that it was used less than they had hoped for. So at Schiphol, for instance, they were expecting 5 million users in a year, and they only had about 2 million in the first year and a half, so that was well below expectations. And finally, when we interviewed all these passengers, 75% told us that they'd never used it. And from these non-users, about 76% had not even ever heard of e-gates, didn't know what it was. So, and we wanted to know, why are people not using those e-gates? You know, they are available, they might speed up the process. So turned out that there are a lot of different reasons. As I said, the majority was that people just didn't know about them, had no idea that they existed. Secondly, a lot of people didn't know they had an e-passport, didn't know what it meant, didn't know there was a chip on the passport they could use. And the other thing was that they couldn't find the e-gates. And it is true, if you look at these airports, that they're often laid out in a way that you have to pass manual gates before you get to the e-gates. So people just line up, you know, just join the queue and don't look, is there another way of getting through border control? And they also said, which was quite interesting, because we interviewed these people at Frankfurt where they have e-gates, and people said, well, I would use them if I was at an airport where they had them. And I was like, well, they do have them over here. And we're like, oh, well, I didn't know that, you know. So another thing is that people tend to choose the familiar over the new. So what we saw in our observations is that people tended, if both the manual gates were open and the e-gates were open and there were no queues at all, people tended to go to the manual ones. And at the moment, because of how these systems are designed, manual is often, if there's no queue, quicker than no queue e-gates. So then you have excluded groups, children can't use it, people in wheelchairs can't get through it, people below a certain height can't use them. And for a lot of people, the benefits are not that clear, because people are still struggling with the e-gates, so it's not really that much faster for people. So, as I said, the e-gates are still under development, and there are still a lot of problems related to the usability of the systems, and there is a lack of harmonization. So in one airport you have to look up to have your face scanned, in another one you have to look, you know, face ahead to have your face scanned. So people get confused, they don't really know what to do, and they experience service failure, either to technical or human error, and this might make them decide next time not to use it and just use the manual. So what we saw was that people, we saw one system, for instance, where the instruction screen was on a loop. So when people approached the gate, they did not necessarily get the first instruction. So people got very confused about that, didn't know how to put their passport on the machines and things like that. But people also, for instance, would hold their passport up to the instruction screen. Or if they had to have their face scanned, they didn't really know where they looked. And of course, developers keep coming up with ideas to improve this. So for instance, with the facial scan, what they did at Schiphol was that they would have a wavy hand in front of the camera. But instead of it attracting attention from people started waving back and got photos with the hands in front of the face. So things like that are really interesting. So instead of making it better, you just make it worse. So sometimes you see that the data on the e-passports are of insufficient quality. That often depends on the country where they're from, and it mainly has to do with the passport photo, which in some cases is stretched, or they've used red eye reduction, and therefore the color of the eyes doesn't fit, you know, the live image. So all these sort of things have an impact on usability. What we also saw is that when there were, for instance, 5 or 6 gates opened, people would tend to just queue in front of 2 of them so that they had the opportunity to look at what other people were doing, because they are insecure about how does this really work. So instead of using all the gates, they rather queue up so that they have some time to sort of check out how it works. So what really surprised me, because I'm interested in privacy issues, is that privacy concerns didn't really come up. Only 3% of the people we interviewed voiced concerns about this. And I think that it has mainly to do with the context in which these biometrics are used. People are so used already to being questioned at a border that they are sort of willing to provide all this information. And people in the focus group we found are not aware of how long is this data stored, where is it stored, who has access to it, what is it used for, and they just assume the worst. They think it's stored forever. They think everybody, Interpol, police, government, everybody's got access. And they're very surprised when they hear that your data, when you put your passport down, is no longer there, it's just there for about an hour. So, what we also talked about was function creep, because normally you see that people are concerned about function creep, like if I put my passport down and this information is on a database, what is it used for and who else is going to use it? In this case, that was not, you know, that didn't apply. But what we did find was that people saw a function creep in a different way. They felt like, well, if it's used for one purpose and we all get used to it at the border, how does this become normalized in other situations? You know, we talked, for instance, about the corridor scenario. So this was talking about how will it work in the future. And the idea was that a lot of the technology developers are thinking about a corridor where you just walk through and then your biometrics are read from a distance. So you don't have to queue up, it's fast, you know, you don't even notice it. And at first people said, oh, that's quite handy. And then when they started thinking about it, they said, one sentence. So,
I'm very strict.
Okay.
Go on, no, finish your sentence, I didn't mean that.
So people felt awkward about it becoming sort of detached from their body. So putting your finger down, you know that it's being read, that somebody's doing something with your data, but having it read from a distance was scary, because what then are they going to do with these supermarkets? Is it going to be used elsewhere? So that kind of function creep was something that concerned them.
All right, thank you so much. Sorry we don't have more time, because it's so interesting, but we have a number of speakers, so thank you. Irma, I think you're next.
Yeah.
No, they'll do it. They do it from here. Yeah, they'll do it for you.
If you want it, there you are. Okay. No.
It's on the desk. Oh, it is on the desk.
Maybe it's downstairs. Is that one? Where? Is it this one?
Yeah, this is the one, but I don't know where the
thing is.
Oh.
Okay. Just the arrow.
This one.
The question raised to the panelists was what the purpose is of these ABC gates. Well, I guess the answer to that is a bit of everything. And the problem is that you only really know if you would know exactly what is being checked and against what. So it depends on which database the biometrics, for example, will be checked against, so that you know that it's about immigration control or also a police search. You know, if it's also checked against an Interpol database, that would be sort of a giveaway that it's also for law enforcement purposes and crime prevention. So it depends on the very precise configuration of what these ABC gates look like and what they do, what the functionality is. And that is still very much in development and flexible, so I think we should really take a close look at what of the exact configuration. I'm going to talk more specifically about biometrics in this little talk. The purpose of biometric, well, the history of biometric, we shouldn't forget, of course, is very much a story about a solution looking for a problem. And we all know that it has been marketed heavily by the biometrics industry, and there has been actually a tremendous technology push here. And also, it's also a well-documented fact that within the EU, the push for security technology development had a lot to do with stimulating economic competitiveness and industry. Ben Hayes has written a very interesting report about the role of industry in setting the research agenda for security technologies in Europe, and also shown that these very same companies often were also the main beneficiaries of the quite enormous budgets reserved for this. But biometrics in border management security, there has already been quite some extensive research being done on this. I was involved from 2004 on the first project on biometrics technology and ethics, and a series of projects after that. So there is already quite some work done on this, and most of these projects involve actually the border management and security applications of biometrics, because they are so politically and ethically sensitive, I guess, and also because they were the main areas in which this was piloted. an ongoing project. Fast Files has been mentioned. I'm in the ethical advisory board of that project, and I'm involved in another project about the development of a handheld mobile identification device, also involving biometric features used for land borders. So it's a lot going on in this area. What I will address in this talk is a few of the promises of biometrics in particular. I think the first one, many of you may have heard about this. This is the idea that biometrics provides really reliable and truthful identification and verification. And the next one is that biometrics, by bypassing the human judgment of the border guard, sort of may be more objective than the human checks performed now. And one of the main reasons also that you find the most passion reports is that it will be more efficient for travelers. That was one of the main reasons that you also talked about. I will leave that for now, but it must be said that there is actually some evidence, or it has been suggested that the main reason why they appear to be more efficient and quick at the moment is indeed that it's only a very small minority of the travelers that use them. So there are actually much shorter queues. If everybody would start using these gates, it's very much a question. It remains to be seen how much more efficient and quick this actually will be. And a lot of that will depend, of course, on the usability and the error rates and the problems caused, or how well the system will function. So, the body does not lie. This is one of the main selling myths, one could say, about biometrics. Biometric identity is often taken as the true identity, right? Unfalsifiable, as opposed to something a person might say about themselves or something they might have. And this idea, it suggests the sort of immediate access to bodily features that you can then use for processing and comparison. However, as I try to put down in this slide, this is far besides the truth. There is no immediate comparison of any bodily feature at all. But what you have in any biometric system, that it involves a very long chain of what we call in science technology chains of translation. So you start with a bodily feature, but that needs to be caught by an input device, a sensor or a camera. It involves digitalization, feature extraction. Well, I can go over this, but this is also this is the enrollment, and the first comparison image of the reference image that needs to be produced and then stored on the chip on the passport. When you come at the gates, you get the second image. This is also going through a censoring device that needs to be captured, it needs to be processed, it needs to be algorithmically transformed, and then it needs to be compared with this other image. So you have data transferred to some point. It depends on where this happens locally or whether it goes to a database for the one-to-one identification stuff. But you see, there's a lot of steps involved. And the main point about this is that at every one of these steps, there are engineering choices being made. And contingency comes into the very design of the technology. And this is not a criticism, this is unavoidable. It happens in every system, of course. But the issue is that once these things function, all these choices and these continued factors shaping the design and configuration of such a system are black boxed. And the whole thing is opaque and intransparent, and you don't know where the choices were and what the threshold setting policies were or whatever. All these steps involve those things, and it becomes very difficult to, if anything goes wrong, to locate where exactly this happened and what it is due to. And this makes it also very difficult to understand and to contest for users, passengers, but also for the border guards who tend to rely on this, of course. And the next idea, that this is more objective than human checking. I want to talk now a little bit about these inbuilt choices and continued factors that I mentioned just now. Underlying the idea of biometrics is an idea of the human body that is that contains very normative assumptions of what a human body looks like and what it is. First, and this is the most familiar one, of course, is that every human body is unique, so this speaks to the unicity of everyone. This is the primary basis for the very idea of biometrics to use it for identification of individuals, of course. It's a valid assumption, but in view of the definition of a match, in terms of probability, this also means that if a score is like 90%, that there is room for the possibility that another person is singled out as a matter of head. This, even the unicity is not entirely, in the way the system operates, not entirely straightforward. But the second one is much less acknowledged. There is also an assumption in any biometric system that human bodies are similar. And the idea of universality, of what the human body looks like. It is assumed, for example, that everybody has 10 fingers with readable fingerprints, that they have clearly defined irises and faces, and they have two legs, and their hands have certain shapes, and so on. They have an audible voice, if you do talk about voice recognition. There is an idea of the human body written in the biometric system that people share all these features. Well, to a large extent, again, this assumption is warranted, but of course, we all know that there are exceptions to this, and there are people who are different, and that there are human bodily differences. And these differences, they tend to interfere with the functioning of the system, and the problem is that this function that's sometimes caused by these differences is not randomly distributed over the entire population, but it hits, so to say, specific categories of people more extensively than others. Okay. So, for example, children, or an example with iris recognition, for example, you need to have the clearly visible irises, and for a lot of Asian people, it turns out to be really difficult to have their irises scanned and reviewed. There is a thing about skin color in facial recognition that it turns out, depending on the training set that the system was developing with, that it can recognize certain types of skin color much better than others. And the thing is that these differences, the particular differences that make a difference to the biometric system, are sensitive ones. It is about medical histories of people. It is about skin color, as I suggested. It can be about gender or age. And these are ethically quite significant differences. So it's not that the system functions randomly over the entire population, but that it singles out certain categories of people who are either excluded from the use of the system or who are more easily recognized and therefore can experience more intense surveillance than other categories of people who can sort of lead around. There's a lot to talk about here, but okay, main conclusions then. We're talking about traveling, air travel, we heard the numbers just now. So in contrast to the context of development of most systems, the context of use involves the maximum range of human body differences you can imagine, of course, because it's people from all over the globe. And then, in addition to that, the scale of the application. Even small error rates, every biometric system has a certain error rate. But if you roll it out on the scale as we see today, in absolute numbers, these numbers are going to be high. And then border passage, it's not an innocent context. It's a very, very high stake context, I would say. It's about issues of asylum, about migration. It's about the prevention of human trafficking. It's about dignity and bodily integrity. It's about counter-terrorism, freedom of movement, what have you. It's all these very, very important fundamental rights issues that are played out and performed at the border. So when these systems malfunction or treat people differently, this is a serious ethical concern. So does that mean that we shouldn't do this? Does it mean that it cannot work? No, of course not. But I think, for now it's a bit lame maybe, but we should evaluate it carefully and look really into the heart of these systems and monitor continuously. Okay, I'll leave it now.
That's perfect timing.
Good.
Yeah, thanks, Irma, that's great. I think our next speaker is Mark. I think you're next up. Mark Maguire from University.
No.
University.
I'm sorry, I've not used PowerPoint. I should be very quick. I guess the challenge, the purpose, is this discussion of how one goes about understanding the societal impact of automated border control. Part of what I want to do is maybe say something that will sound a little bit methodological. But in other words, how are we actually assessing, or what are we assessing? With users at various different levels. So just more of a vignette than anything else, but a number of years ago I was in the Middle East and the Gulf State of Qatar, and we were rolling out a very extensive biometric system there, and they are, perhaps one could argue, the types of countries that are world leaders here, because they don't necessarily have concepts of fundamental rights and civil liberties in terms of the security technology to roll out there. But already at that stage, not just 5 or 6 years ago, there was discussions of how Sadhbh emergence of what's called second generation biometrics, which is what I want to talk about more specifically. So simply, this is the simple point I want to make, is that when one goes to an airport and maybe talks to travellers and say, what do you think of this new security measure, which most people understand is a question of mobility and efficiency, and there is a 50% increase in airport travellers in the next 20 years. And it's often a very positive response that you get, but that shouldn't reassure us that everything is okay here, because, and it's already been raised earlier, the question is, what are we actually asking people to think about? And is there an informed discussion of this? And I think particularly when one takes this from an angle of counter-terrorism, it sees this kind of sharpening as a point, basically. So, over the last number of years, I've been looking a little bit at counter-terrorism in operational context, but also the technologies that are deployed. And in a forthcoming article with Pete Fussey from the University of Essex, we trace the last number of years, particularly post 9/11, and ask ourselves, well, what are the key trends that have appeared that seem to cut across nation-state borders, and not necessarily United States dominated? Well, first of all, one sees the emergence not just of standard biometric security, but also second-generation biometrics, particularly dominantly in the US. And by that I mean I'll just point to two examples, but already in trial in Europe we find Avatar, which is the automated virtual agent for troop assessments in real time, which is produced by the University of Arizona Border Control Center of Excellence, funded by Homeland Security. And essentially that's, of course, an ATM-sized machine, which does a very crude microfacial expression reading, basically, to see if you're being deceitful. It also, in the US, they're starting to develop the concept of actually searching your social media profile using that machine also. Much more secretively, I guess, with the emergence of future attribute screening technology, which is trialed in a number of airports, which is a mobile information corridor, basically, we mentioned earlier, which looks at everything from fidgeting to skin's electrical resistance, things like that, all in search for something called malintent, which is the kind of classified theory behind this, the idea that your intent to do harm can actually be picked up by technology. Now, I suddenly think, fussy look at this and just think about it simply in terms of a very fixed, very powerful sense that the human body, but also human emotional affect, can be read by technology, and that will be a trend that shapes counterterrorism in the years to come. But alongside that, we also have other forms of abnormal behavior detection that we've defined as constructivist subjectivities. In other words, abnormal behavior detection systems being used in deployments by counterterrorism operations in airports. And both myself and people actually trained in those systems. So they would include BAS, most famously, of course, the spot program run by the Transport Security Administration in the US, which are essentially sweeps looking for abnormal behavior. So even when we look at, and these are two trends that just seem to rest and right uncomfortably alongside one another, but when we look at it, we look at something like ABC technology, it is the case that it's nested within these broader kind of counter-terrorism systems also, but also there's very specific questions will emerge in the near future, which is my key word for today. In other words, how do you assess methodologically the near future? So within that then, one would have to look at the fact that with that huge increase of passengers, there's going to be a very direct attempt to explore non-intrusive mobile scanning of usually face recognition, which is a very obvious thing to use. And in other words, we will be passing through corridors in the next 20 years easily, and things will be done quite remotely. The technology now does not support that. 2D face recognition is not possible to do with such a high resolution. So it's often supplemented in different countries with what's called soft biometrics or demographic data, in other words, height, gender, skin color, ethnicity, things like this, in order literally to correct the system that's that error prone. Will it change the future of the technology grown at an amazing pace? Absolutely. But what one also will probably see is much more heavy use of algorithms to detect abnormal behavior within the airport spaces, for example. And that's already in the background. So here's my question then. If we're actually talking to users, be it border guards, whether we're down to passengers in airports, should we really be talking to them about not just a measure, basically, within an airport, but that context and asking them to think through the near future in terms of whether they're actually comfortable with it? It's not that far away. These are the kind of things that are in the fast track, basically. So I just want to make an empirical point here. But I want to call your attention to the fact that, you know, why am I mentioning things like abnormal behavior detection? Well, the research I did included discussions with people who invented some of these types of systems, including Bass very particularly. I particularly speak of Peter DiDominica here, the Boston Lieutenant Colonel, who was one of the people involved in the incident with Richard Reed, who's an incident commander, his second command, sorry. But he pointed out something very, very important here. Is that if you look at this very basically, we have this enormous flow of passengers. The problem that the solutioners was trying to fit with is the idea of how to sift the good from the bad, basically, how to speed up the mobility of the vast majority of people, but isolate those others. Now, automated border control per se doesn't work, because as he pointed out, people like Richard Reed, their passport was in order. Biometrically, they were safe people. It was something like hostile intent that needed to be detected, basically. And there's some argument that the system actually worked with regard to that. So let me just drill down a little bit further here. Let's point out the fact that the ACLU, of course, famously took this entire system through the courts, basically, pretty soon after it was developed. And it was deemed not unconstitutional, actually, because this is about elevating suspicion of voting here within critical infrastructure. In 2013, the US Government Accountability Office argued that the $900 million spent on the TSA spot program from 2007 to 2013, it should probably be abandoned because it presented no value for money, and I'm quoting here directly, because there was an absence of scientifically validated evidence behind it. But yet it's still in operation. The question for me is, how, for example, would an organization like the DHS defend something that was judged to have at least very weak scientific evidence behind it? And their argument simply was this, and this is in the House of Representatives discussion: borders are complex and multi-layered. You can't assess one measure in isolation, especially when the one measure they were being assessed is actually a classified secret in terms of its theory, right? But the point they made is actually, I think, quite valid. It is not possible to assess these things in one particular historical moment with one measure. We must be thinking through as a society, and particularly our airport users, about the full complexity of these types of measures. And actually, you know what, that's all I want to say.
Thanks, Mark. Mark, having actually gone under time by 1 or 2 minutes, I'm going to hand over to Peter Gregg. It's quite timely now because Peter's coming from the technical side as well as the border control side of the bus. So, interesting to hear your perspective now.
Okay, thank you, Sadhbh. Good morning, everybody. Just by way of a brief introduction to my background, born and educated in Ireland, spent 20 years working for the Home Office in the United Kingdom, primarily in the immigration and border control world, and the last 8 years working at IBM. I should say a couple of things about IBM in this context. IBM don't do biometrics, and we don't do ABC systems. We do other background border control systems, but we're not particularly in that space. But what I want to focus, I talk about this morning, is my experience working for the Home Office in the UK, and the three projects that I was involved in that were ABC related. The very first of those was a trial back in 2001 where we really just tested whether we could use a biometric to identify somebody to a sufficient degree of accuracy to allow us to get that person through the border in an automated way, and we used iris technology for that. It was a 3-month trial. It gave us quite a bit of useful information and sufficient information that allowed us to then go and launch a proper, what I call a proper program, registered traveller program called the Irish program, which was launched in 2005. Now, my experience of developing the business case, the policy, the legal framework for all of these programs, in all cases, is that there's only one reason governments introduce these programs, and that is to save money. Yeah. Now, there's a context to that. They have at the same time, while looking to save money, they have to make sure that they don't degrade the security of the border control. So alongside this desire to save money, they are looking at something that is at least as secure as the systems they already have in place. If they wanted to save money, it needs to work, and it needs to have high adoption rate, which means it needs to be attractive to users. But everything is supporting this idea of trying to save money. And some of it comes to what Mark said, which is that it's completely lost my thread now, sorry.
Mention my name and
everything. Yeah, the case in the UK, I mean, let me go back, let me take a step back. I mean, the case, the business case that we built in the UK to justify an expenditure of several million pounds to introduce these gates was that we got people through more quickly using the type of system than if they went and saw a border guard. And if we had sufficient number of crossings across the gate, then savings in time multiplied up to a sufficient number to actually to give you quantifiable cash savings. So that's where we had the business cases were founded. For the IRIS system that we developed in 2005, and for a further iteration of that some years later, which was the MySense pilots, which we did in collaboration with airlines, with airport authorities, and with industry. And that reminds me now of the point that I was going to make. When we launched the IRIS program, I was one of the first persons to register. I was traveling quite a bit at the time, both looking at what other countries were doing in this regard, but just generally in my role, where I had an international responsibility. And so I registered in the IRIS program, I flew out of the UK, came back in, and used the gates, and felt really quite good because I just sailed through. And I had lots of time to think about how great that was, about 50 minutes actually, to be precise, sitting in the baggage hall waiting for my bag to come through. Yeah, and this takes me to the point, is that if you don't look at this thing in its entirety, from a passenger's point of view, then you really, really missed the trick. And I think, in my mind, that's one of the things that we have, one of the comments we've made in written communications with the European leadership, European administration, which is to say that it needs to be looked at in the context of the whole passenger journey. It's not enough to say we get you through the border control securely and quickly. Because if it just leads to a queue somewhere else in the airport, then it's not very good for the passenger. It's not very good for the flow of people through that whole travel continuum. And what is often a bottleneck, and it's not just the border control that's the bottleneck, it's the baggage, it's the security checkpoints, it's all of those things. So we strongly believe that this needs to be looked at together with airlines, with airports, with other port operators where the systems are being looked to be deployed outside of the aviation environment. I'm not aware of any really sophisticated schemes outside of that, with the exception perhaps of Southeast Asia, where you've got a number of land border crossings, where you see people, for instance, crossing from Malaysia into Singapore every day, tens of thousands of people coming across the land border, but the environment is very similar to an airport environment because there are people walking through a barrier using an identity card. So, we talked a bit about the business case. The practical experiences, and I think, you know, relevant to this particular discussion. So I have to keep my fingers crossed to turn this thing off. Yeah. I don't have to remember my password. The experiences that we've seen over the years, so when we introduced the IRIS scheme, I sort of equate it really to self-service in a supermarket. It's really giving people an option. People an option to self-serve their way through a particular part of the journey. And equally, as I say to people, quite often they say, oh, it's terrible, you know, these new gates, there's huge queues. And there's nobody standing in front of the immigration officer. Well, why don't you go and see the immigration officer then? You have a choice. You know, the fact that you can use one doesn't mean to say you can't use the other. So it's really, you should be seen by people as a choice. But the important design factors, because I do start from this, and IBM tends to start from this, from this position. Technology can do just about anything you want it to do in this environment. You need to decide what you want it to do, and you need to decide how you want it to work. So this whole design, and designing in of human factors into these systems is absolutely critical if you want to drive up intake, if you want to drive up use. So we spent a lot of time, I suppose, particularly after the first pilot we did, when we learned a lot of lessons, about how do we make these systems more usable? How do we make sure they're properly signposted, properly advertised in advance, and when people arrive into the border control hall, that they're properly signposted? How do we make sure that instructions are available in multiple languages in a way that people find easy to use, you know, and not something where, you know, somebody described earlier, on a loop, when you come away halfway through the loop and you get completely confused. You know, it's very simple. It's those types of factors. We were, I think, probably quite fortunate at the time that we introduced the IRIS project, particularly, because we had a Home Secretary at the time, who was David Blunkett, who was known he also registered in the programme. And as he said, you know, we discovered that blind people still have an iris that can be recognised, but the problem that they would have, obviously, is how do they find the gates? How do they navigate themselves towards the gates? And how do they actually use the gates? How do they know where to stand? And so we had somebody who had a real stake in that, who was really interested, who helped us test a lot of those concepts. We built gates that were big enough for wheelchairs, for instance. So we were looking at a range of factors that, from our point of view, we wanted lots of people to use the gates, so we needed them to be as easy to use as possible. So they're in my experience, some of the really key factors. Okay, I've got to stop watching this.
2 minutes.
Yeah, I'm not nearly done.
It's hard, keep going.
I thought I had 12.
No, you did not think you had 12. It's 10 minutes. I told everybody. I'm very strict.
Okay.
No favouritism of the occasion.
But Mark only used 8.
Yeah, he didn't say you could have the extra 2. Didn't say you could. I'm selling the extra 2 minutes to one of the panelists.
I pretty much finished that.
No, you're fine. Keep going. No, you've got 8
minutes. No, fine. I mean, I think I've covered that point about it. Just what we call the human factors. It's just making sure that you take all of those things into account. Because, again, it's a point Mark raised that I'll finish on. The analogy that I've always used from a border control management point of view is that border control is often like trying to find a needle in a haystack. Traditionally, the law enforcement approach has been to find stronger and stronger magnets so that it makes it easier to get at the needle. I think the adoption of registered traveller programmes have allowed them to change the mindset a little bit and say, let's take away large parts of the haystack before we start looking for the needle, and the haystack being those very, very high proportion of low-risk travellers who really, you just want to get through the process as quickly as possible. So, in our minds, the ABC systems, as they've emerged, have allowed border control authorities to do that. Lots and lots of low-risk people through the border control, allowing the human resources to focus on those people who might be more of a threat or might be unknown and therefore need to be examined more closely. That's
what you think.
Thank you.
Anyway,
that's my experience.
That's your experience. No, Peter, thank you very much. That's great. Our final speaker today is Gemma Clavell. Gemma is actually the work package leader and societal impact within the ABC4U project. As we mentioned earlier, ABC4U is convening this panel today. And it's really interesting because it's a lot with FastPass. It's a project that has a dedicated societal impact work package within the project, so that it's not just sort of that we review it at the end, but done alongside. I'll hand over to Joe now. Just give you a little bit of information about ABC4U, as we're the sponsors of this panel today.
Thank you. Thanks. Well, for anyone working on the societal impact of data-intensive technologies, and ABC data are clearly data-intensive technologies, especially if they're biometric enabled, having panels like this is what we wish to have in the development phase of the technology. We want to have all these inputs and all these being taken into account, the business perspective, the anthropological perspective, the perspective of the social scientists working on helping us all understand what the challenges are. However, I think that's becoming more and more the case, but it's still a challenge. So, as Sai was saying, I work at Eticas and work on the societal impact of data-intensive technologies. And what we do is a bit different from what the others do, because we try to build all these into the specific technological design. So it's not just giving information that may or may not reach whoever's designing the technology, but we actually try to work alongside the technologists and see how we build legal code and societal concerns into technological code, basically, and technology. So just a bit about the project. We submitted ABC4U in 2011, so quite a long time ago already, even though we've only been working for a year. We wrote the ethical work package in 2011, when there was not a big pressure for large companies to include ethical partners in the projects. And I think that the fact that Indra, interestingly, that the coordinator of the project invited us, had a lot to do with the full body scanner space. And the fact back then we're all talking about what happened with full body scanners and how society was rejecting them and not wanting to go through this new technology that was supposed to make us all more secure. So all of a sudden, all the companies working in airport technologies realized that they had a problem with acceptability. Not just the legality of the systems, but also how people react to that, to them. And if people don't want to use them, then they're going to be a failure. And the pilot that you developed at great expense will not be sold. And so I think that's one of the reasons why Inca invited us to develop this work package and to write this this work package. However, it was written in 2011, and I guess if we did it today, we'd do it quite differently. All in all, that we have one work package, which is a great privilege. Not in many large technological projects where you can work with your own work package. You're usually just a very small partner that plays a hand every once in a while, and no one listens to. So we have a whole work package, 11 deliverables. We've published 7 deliverables in the first year, so it's been a really intense year, and by LinkedIn is testimony to that. We provided a legal framework and the special clause 15 compliance with their protection authorities. We've done case studies, but we haven't done field work in the sense that the FastPass partner described. We've used what other people have done. We've tried to build on existing research, existing data sets, existing surveys, and so we've looked at the diverse geographics, at the legal status of users, deployment scenarios, and the acceptability by all the stakeholders. But as I said, by using examples from that other people have done and work that already exists. We've developed a methodology and training mechanisms. And basically, we've tried to ingrain a responsible research and innovation approach into the project and also into the technologists. So we'd like them to use what they learn in ABC4U in whatever else they do in the company. So the goal that we have is that we are present throughout the project. We do an initial assessment, that's the part that we just finished, and then we can audit every single technology that is developed inside the project, and then we do an evaluation at the end. That's how we've imagined the development of the work package. And now the main challenge is how do you build Schengen, the Schengen border code, into the technology? One of the things that was quite surprising, or maybe not, but is that I don't think we've met any border guard, police, technology developer, no one in the project or outside the project who actually read the Schengen Border Code, which is what should inform everything that you do. And if you read the Schengen Border Code, it says quite interesting things, and this is just an abstract, but Schengen says that border guards shall fully respect human dignity, that any measures that they take shall be proportionate, and border guards shall not discriminate on the basis of race, gender, blah, blah, blah. So dignity, proportionality, and non-discrimination, that's pretty big things for a legal code, for a Schengen border code. It also says that all persons, and that only applies to nationals, to Schengen nationals, shall undergo a minimum check. It should be rapid and straightforward. It could use technical devices, and databases can be consulted, but only on information on stolen, misappropriated, lost or invalidated documents. And on a non-systematic basis, border guards may consult national and European databases in order to ensure that whoever is going through the gate does not represent a genuine, present, and sufficiently serious threat. So that quite limits and defines what the limit of what you can do at the border. You don't need to go beyond this to understand the challenges that you're facing. But if no one reads this, if no one understands what they should adhere to, then how can you build a technology that adheres to something that you don't know? And that's one of the main challenges that we've had. How do we build this? How do we get the stakeholders to understand that this is their Bible? But also, how do we get them to understand that it's not just about technological choices, but also about understanding this broader context? When Schengen says that Schengen nationals need to undergo a minimum check, and that this minimum check is different from the one that non-nationals undergo, is because of our definition of citizenship. And that is what's at stake when we develop ABC gates. Technologists and companies tend to want to have the same ABC gate for nationals and non-nationals. And that seriously undermines our definition of citizenship. We understand that citizens have a right to enter their own country, even if they're criminals. You have a right to enter your space of sovereignty, even if you are a criminal. And it's hard for companies and technologists to understand that. Issues of proportionality and accountability, again, how do you build that into the technology? It's not even in the agenda of most of the companies, even though their Bible says that they should be taking this into account. And also risk assessment. You should only stop people when they represent a serious threat. Who is assessing this and how are they doing this? So we needed to build all these legal and ethical precautions into our work, but also include acceptability because of the experience with full body scanners. Issues of desirability, do we, as a society, do we want this to be developed? Is this better than other alternatives? Issues of feasibility, sometimes technologies are a bit non-realistic about the possibilities of the technology, and we needed to put this on the table. And issues of data management, because when you check against databases, that's complicated. And there's an issue with reality. if you were to develop the perfect ABC gate, then you would check everyone against all known databases and have a perfect picture of that specific traveler. Well, nation states do not share the databases, so you can't do that. If I go with my ID to a French ABC gate, the French ABC gate will not be able to open my electronic ID because they don't have access to the database. I mean, and that's the way nation states work. And it doesn't look like that's going to change in the near future. Actually, we're going the other way. So that needs to be taken into account. You cannot build a system and sell a system that promises to check everyone against the database when you will never have access to that database. And I'm not getting into whether that's good or bad. That's the way it is. So if you build a system that does promises to do things that cannot be done, you're not selling something that's going to be very useful, are you? So what we did, we developed a methodology that we use in most of our projects, which is based on four main tiers, and that guides the way that we look at how and what the technologies are doing, and that's what we try to train them in. That they need to look at the desirability of the systems, and that's mainly the policy and the options that they have. Could you do something else that could yield the same result? So look beyond what it is that you've been told to do and think about alternatives. Acceptability, that's about how people react to your system and whether they have enough information about it. Ethics, values, proportionality, discrimination, etc. And data management. Here we get into these, is the data encrypted? Are there harmonization techniques, etc., etc., etc. I'm not sure I have time for this, but okay, no. Some interesting things that we found is that many new ABC gate systems are not legal, do not comply with the existing legal framework at the EU level. And because there's this perception there's a legal void, because the Smart Borders Initiative will be rolled out, because there's going to be a new EU data protection, it's like the current law has disappeared. And we are acting on a board, so we can do whatever we want at border crossings, because until all these new things are enacted, basically we have nothing to adhere our systems to, which is false. I mean, there is a current legal framework, and you have the Schengen border code. So that's quite worrying. And also the issue of going from ideal to real, and getting real about database access, which is not a vulnerability level. So what do we do in specific terms to build this into the project? This is what we come up with, something like this with every work package, where we identify all the tasks that need to be done, and we use a color code for ourselves, but also for the technologies, where we say, you're fine here, you're clear, or this may be an issue, and here we need to work with you more intensively. Where we have text codes as well to identify whether the challenges are about acceptability, desirability, ethics, or data management. And we also develop scoreboards where we give points to different things linked again to desirability, acceptability, ethics, and data management in some of the options that need to be taken. So if you want to deploy an ABC gate, the ABC gate can take different forms. It can be a one-step ABC gate where you only introduce your biometric data once. It can be an integrated two-step ABC gate where you do it twice but in the same machine, so to speak. Or it can be a segregated two-step ABC gate where you go through different doors at different moments. In this case, for instance, we found that using the one-step ABC gate was the best solution in terms of desirability, acceptability, ethics, and data management. This also includes financial reasons, by the way. But this gives the technologies something to go back to and look at actually what are the strong points and the weak points of what I'm trying to develop. And actually, one of the reasons that we found one of the systems in the EU to be illegal was the fact that they used the segregated two-step ABC gate. That meant basically that you had to keep biometric data. And if you're a national, you're supposed to only, the system's supposed to only verify your identity. But of course, if there's two doors that are separated, then you're storing the data. And just because of that quite stupid final design decision, they turned what could have been a perfectly legal system into an illegal system for a bad decision that someone took at the final stage of the deployment. And just to finish, we're only beginning to do the audits. Some of the successes we've had so far, all the partners are going to take encryption by design. The partner developing the algorithmic technology has committed to a biometric crypto engine. The tech fingerprint solution that is being played with in the Smart Borders Initiative has been discarded. And the principle of data minimization is going to be used in database integration. So we see some progress in how technologists are approaching these issues, and we feel that it's being a success. We still have 2.5 years to work ahead of us. But some of the challenges is the peripheral sensing that came up in some of the issues and some of the other contributions. You don't only check passengers at the ABC gate. We're moving towards this corridor idea. And in the project, we concentrate very much on the ABC gate, when actually there's a lot of other sensing technologies that are being deployed before and after going through the ABC gate. And that is definitely a challenge that we have, because we do not want to have a rights-based gate and an invasive technology before and after it. Now we hear Sadhbh.
She tells me to be a good timekeeper. Okay, so I can throw open the panel onto the floor. Has anybody actually, you know, got a specific question or have a comment based on what they've heard so far? Yeah, sorry. Do you mind actually just giving your name just for context? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
To the processes that EU citizens should go through, but there is another set of requirements that apply to third country nationals, which involve further challenges for automated border control, like the stamping obligation, which is one of them. Is ABC for EU also looking at whether and how third country nationals could also be using the ABC gates? Because we know that the challenges are much more.
Yeah, but basically the conclusion is that it's the same with minors. Minors and third country nationals, with the legal framework that we have right now, cannot use ABC gates. Or an ABC gate could be a part of the border check, but you have to go through a person, because Schengen is very clear about this. And that's another of the challenges that we're facing, because the companies want to sell a system that's good for everyone. So they want to go from the two queues, you know, nationals, non-nationals, to one single queue. And as we said, this is about the definition of citizenship. Exactly. So yeah, you cannot change that with a technical amendment, which is what some companies have been trying to push at the EU level. So we have to wait for the new border smart borders initiative.
Actually, I was just going to... Peter, do you have any comments on that? I mean, more from the sort of more practical experience, because it's sort of, sometimes the technologies have a sort of slightly different perspective.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think the first thing to point out is there's been some comments about technologists sort of, you know, trying to design these things. Technologists respond to... tenders from government which set out the requirements that the technologist is supposed to meet. So the technologists aren't the ones who are setting those requirements, the governments are setting those requirements, and the technologists are trying to meet them. Now, there is a dialogue, and this probably goes to your point, Gemma, there is a dialogue between technology and government, and particularly the European Commission have made their views and their ambitions in this area very clear, and they have said that they would like to see the cost of individual gates drop to something like €5,000 per gate. As part of that dialogue, obviously, technology companies are going to respond and say, well, you could do that, and here's some of the ways you could do it.
Yeah.
You know, so that's really just a dialogue about how two parties can have their requirements met. But at the end of the day, the government is the one who set the requirements, it's not the technology companies. Technology companies have to meet those requirements.
That's true, if it weren't for the fact that technology companies often, you know, let's say, influence the demand side. I mean, the supply side does sometimes influence the demand side.
Yeah.
But I do take it.
There is a dialogue, of course, there has to be a dialogue. Yeah.
Okay, let's call it a dialogue.
No, but also to their credit, we find not only in this project, but also in private contract that we have, that more and more companies are realizing that they cannot rely on the specifications of government, because if they follow the specifications of government, and then what they do is not accepted by the population, they will not be able to sell it. And so I think it's more complex than that.
Yeah. Sorry, this, two, okay, one, two, three. You heard the man, 5 minutes. So if you could make your questions quick, I'll take actually the three questions together and then, go ahead.
Yeah, Luc Beersom from the Free University of Brussels. So myself, I'm being very much involved in this kind of project where you try to combine technology and society. So a constructive technology system, what you're talking about. So how to develop values into systems. And what I was wondering is, what I really like about your talks and about the project in general, I think, is you go beyond the so-called work package one syndrome, which means that as a social scientist, you go to a project, you write a big report, and then say, okay, nice, and then you're leaving the project. So what I did like, what you mentioned, that you're really dedicated to work package, but my question is then, as our experience working in this field, especially with technological people, the most important thing is to get it also into other work packages, especially the technical ones, trying to understand what is the technical guys are doing, what kind of requirements do they have, how can we get an impact on that? And my question is then, you mentioned a little bit about requirements you were involved in and you assessed these, so I'm wondering more detail about how you got secure access to really having an impact on the technology side.
Okay, can I just hold that question for a second?
Thanks so much. My name is Nick from the University of Amsterdam. I'm researching mostly new security markets in Europe from a political science perspective. And what I really liked about this panel is basically all the difficulties and problems that come in when designing these technologies. Because when researching the companies, this is, of course, not something that you hear often. So I hear questions about the fact that databases cannot be or databases are not exchanged or integrated, the fact that there's two steps and therefore there's a problem with stored data and legal things. So one thing I was going to ask is, I've seen companies that develop also a sort of corridor experience, and that market this as something that can be that can be implemented in a few years from now, which I guess is questionable. And some of them also talk about some sort of virtual identifier.
We were just asking to, because other people want to ask as well, and we only have a few minutes. Maybe if you could.
And so, also talk about a virtual identifier is kind of go away from the idea that so data is stored, is also removed afterwards, but is not linked to the person anywhere. I'm positive with this idea of a virtual identifier, so I was just going to throw it in and see if you've heard about it and know what it means.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, the lady at the back and then this thing, but could you just keep it very brief, just
yeah.
to kind of put your questions out?
I'm Terry Schultz, I'm a journalist, I write for Security Europe. Hey, Seth. My question is much less technical, and sorry, I missed the beginning. How do you think that all the talk now, I mean, just in the last couple of months about, I mean, the terrorism, the threat of terrorism, how it's affecting the entire way people think about Schengen, will that have any impact on your project? You know, wanting to throw out Schengen for any outsiders, and also on the public's acceptability of new technologies like this because of the threat that they're now feeling. I mean, I was here when we had the scanner issue, the full body scanner. But as people become more afraid of who's getting in, how does that impact the acceptability that you mentioned? Thanks.
Thanks, Terry. Sorry, one last one.
I would like to ask the first speaker. I think you, Anne-Marie, you said that you have identified that the people that you have interviewed are worried about the possible function creep of their data. And I'm wondering whether you know or you have some indications whether the same people would be similarly worried about a function creep if they would pass through conventional gates and not the ABC gates.
Okay,
because I mean, there are the same data that are being exchanged.
Yeah, okay. So I think actually, because Anne-Marie hasn't come back and said this, so you might want to take that first, Anne-Marie, just briefly, because I'll just go through some of the questions before we finish.
I think that people are not so much concerned about the data and the function creep of the data, as I explained, because like I said, they are used to having to answer questions and sort of justify why they go to Mars or where they're from. It's more that they were concerned about if it becomes common in this context, in border context, how will that impact on different contexts? So especially with that corridor and that remote sensing, you know, is this then becoming common when you go into the supermarket or when you know, so that was
really
okay. So that was more what the people we had the focus groups with voiced, and not so much the data that they have on their passport. Also because they said, well, that sort of data is just, they weren't so much concerned about that data as in comparison, for instance, to the data they share on Facebook and all the other. They said, there's so much stuff about me out there anyway, you know.
Mm-hmm.
border control is the least of my worries, to be honest.
Okay. So it is other uses.
Okay, so I think that actually it might lead nicely into the question Terry asked, but it's to do with context as well. I mean, you know, people's level of desirability for security. I mean, Mark, do you want to comment on that? There's just sort of kind of the sense of people being afraid or not afraid. How that?
Yeah, I know a really sharp time. I just.
You take two and do that.
Well, I can talk to you afterwards too if you don't think it applies.
There's a really short answer. I just think people's reaction to a specific measure like ABC, just as common airport travelers would be folded into their sense of how they use Facebook, their iPhones, etc., all this type of thing. But if you confront people with a very clear picture of the context to come in the years to come, I think you get a very different response. And I think I'm not sure that's exactly what's coming out of your work, but I'm pretty convinced that is the case. But just your specific question about counterterrorism and what's happening today in the last couple of weeks, how that will affect people. I mean, I would respond differently on this. I'm taking away from the question of border control, actually say that probably the most interesting way in which this has been framed to my mind has been about the idea of poisonous ideology. It's kind of a 1950s kind of reaction in some ways. And so it's kind of a borderless problem. And I think how that gets folded discursively into discussions of border control would be an interesting thing. In other words, our problem here is not bodies, it's thoughts, basically. So I just thought that was interesting in the media the last number of weeks, actually.
Yeah, I think that is a very good point. I mean, often I think with this, what happens when you focus on something like border control, I mean, Gemma touched on the sort of the issue of it being, you know, it's about citizenship, it's about, you know, and we get very focused on the sort of the physicality of the bodily experience, and we sort of forget about what it is you're trying to do with a border. And I think, because Eileen and I work with on this as well, we're also in the ABC for you, and I think it's one of the most interesting things for me has been kind of seeing that the narrative about what is it a border is trying to do has become lost in a sort of a technological solutionism, which you're trying to say, what is this even measuring? You know, what are you actually trying to do here? You've lost sight of that. There was a good question, which I will throw back to Gemma as well, and actually, Irma, if you want to comment on it, just this idea of how do you embed yourself in, how do you embed yourself within the project? And, you know, Gemma used the term audit, which we actually kind of say all the time, we don't audit, we are not the auditors. We're, you know, we say, no, we're here to help. We're not here to audit you, we're here to help you. Tell us what you want to do and we'll help you find a way to do it that's, you know, nice and legal and acceptable and desirable. But you have to be, I mean, Gemma, let you speak to her, but you must be in the project to do that. You can't be just a separate entity that sort of, you know, looks in on the event. But I mean, I don't know if you want to make any more comment on that.
Just you have to build that in your work package. So half of our time is saved for being to work with other partners. And what we do usually, we build this auditing task or accompanying task in our work package, but then in any task that you feel you need to be included in, you need to put in at least one person a month or half a person a month, but your name needs to be there. Because one of the things that we found happened to us in other projects when we thought, oh, if we just have the time in our work package, then we'll just, you know, we'll be there and say, hey, we'll help you. But if you're not in their work package, in their task, they don't put you in the mailing list.
There's no clue how you can be helping them. So,
you have to impose yourself in that. But I would say in this project we've been quite lucky because they get the issue. I think that the full body scanners change the way that the industry working on airport solutions sees these problems.
Yeah.
And so it's not that complicated. It's hard for them to open their processes, but not because they don't want to, but because it's hard because they work in a company, they're not used to having other people working with them. But they realize that the role that we play is crucial and they want to learn. And I think that's a quite special thing about this project.
Yeah, sorry, Irma, did you want to come in on this?
Oh, yeah, about the time dedicated to these issues over the work package, it's also that the other partners should have time dedicated to work with you guys. They will be pressed for time. I understand that geographically you are dispersed.
Yeah.
You should be there at the crucial stages in the requirements workshops, for example. You should be there.
And
you need
to
the crafting
of the project design. Yeah, but I think also, I would say that, if I'm not very good moderator, I'm chipping into it. But I actually, because this is a nice small group, so it's okay. You know, I mean, I think trust actually between the people doing it, you know, if you're in the board packages with them, you actually establish a relationship of trust where, you know, they see you as actually being there to participate and to work together, not as, you know, you're the auditor, not, you know, I don't mean it like that, but it's certain people. Just that lady, I think the final thing. Peter, did you want to make, I know you were sort of thinking about this virtual identity.
And this is sort of new markets. I mean, is this something that you guys are exploring at all, or?
Virtual, could you just explain that concept of virtual identity?
I don't know, just
but
shortly.
But I think it's a minority report comics. A minority report was filmed 12 years ago, and most of it hasn't happened. So it's like this idea that if we will visualize it, it will happen. Technology will do it. Well, no. Anonymization techniques are not there yet. So you cannot promise you build a corridor where you get all the information and then it magically disappears.
Yeah.
If you create it as a digital piece of information, it can stay there forever. It's very hard to delete or anonymize. So of course the industry is selling these safe corridors where you're checked for whatever time you go through the corridor and then it disappears. That's not technologically feasible at the moment. Not to mention issues of social desirability or acceptability, but it's technologically not feasible.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. It's just companies selling smoke, as they usually do.
Vaporware. We've run over a few minutes of time. I think it was probably worth it. And I guess everybody's going downstairs for coffee now anyway. So thank you very much to all the panel, to our chair, Lotta, from the Federal Agency, Irma, Gemma, Mark, Anne-Marie, and Peter. Thank you all very much. And thank you guys for coming.